Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Nilakshi Jain, Research Coordinator in Shine Anchor Kutchi Engineering College, Mumbai, India, welcomes you in a hybrid webinar series, Innovative and Emerging Technology in Field of Research. This international webinar series is hosted with 25 plus national and international collaborators. And our collaborators are from outside India too. Today, we have our honorable speaker, Professor Uday Bhave sir, and he is going to speak on how database can play a vital role in field of research. He is going to show you the database as a powerful tool. Guys, database is very important whenever you go to implement any project. Now, to take the further session, I would like to call the webinar coordinator, Ms. Radhika Fuljile, Assistant Professor and Webinar Coordinator, Shine Anchor Kutchi Engineering College, Mumbai. I request ma'am to introduce our honorable speaker and to take the session further. She'll be moderator for today's session. Radhika ma'am.
Thank you ma'am. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I, Radhika Fuljile, welcomes you all on behalf of Shah and Anchor Kutchi Engineering College, Mumbai, India. We at Sakek Research Cell will take this opportunity to thank each and every one of you present here today for this hybrid webinar series of Innovative and Emerging Technology in the Field of Research in collaboration with all our partners. Today, our speaker, Mr. Uday Bhave sir, is going to tell us about current trends in database management systems. Our speaker, Mr. Bhave sir, is in charge head computer engineering department, Sakek. He is an experienced professor with a demonstrated history of working in the education management industry. He has diverse education background ranging from electrical diploma, electronics degree, and the master degree focused in computer engineering. His area of interest are in data mining, soft computing, business intelligence, machine learning, and a passion of teaching. He is a strong education professional with 30 years of experience in industry and teaching field with many papers published in conference and journals. Before handing over to our speaker, I would like to make some announcement to all my attendees that if you have any queries to our speaker throughout the session, you can ask via Q&A chat box. Now I hand over the session to our speaker, Mr. Bhave sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah. Good afternoon, all of you. So today's topic is current trends in database management system. We are basically discussing what is happening in the database management industry. The idea is that we will first discuss what is happening in the industry, and then we'll see that as an individual, what way we can contribute as a research student or enthusiast or open source developer. So that is the idea about the today's session. Let me start with the history of the databases. Anyway, we all are aware of that basic things about databases, database management systems, and whatever is going on today, that we are aware. But still, as a completeness, we'll start with the history and then we'll move towards the distributed database and a NoSQL movement, and then what we can take out of the NoSQL movement for requirement of the industry. So obviously from 1970 onwards we'll talk about, because before that relational database system were not there, and then people were working with the flat files and other things. So from 1970 onwards we have something like a very strong database management system, and that we are still using it, that is a relational database management system. And with that, people were thinking that whether the RDBMS is really required now or not. So that is the debate, and that is going on, and that will continue. But still, RDBMS is a major chunk in the entire database industry still. We'll discuss that also afterwards when we discuss more about the NoSQL movement and other things. in 1996 people have thought that okay, we have got something special or we should add some features to the RDMS, that is, which is now termed as in-memory database systems, and that is obviously required because of the data which we using in somewhere in 1980s and now in 1996 onwards, the data or the volume of data has increased tremendously. And 1996 onwards, because of the internet, huge data is possible to store and required to be processed. Added to that, the business intelligence and other things we require to process that streaming data and all those things. And so people were thinking about the in-memory databases, and that is now become a standard. So all new database management systems are working with that, including the older one, that is Oracle, MySQL and all. They are also modifying their DBMS systems so that some part can be processed in memory. And then at 2008 onwards, something new has started up, and that is of course around now 10 to 12 years are over with the NoSQL movement. And that is obviously because of the internet. Everyone is using internet. Lot of data is poured in the internet every millisecond. And so we cannot continue with the relational database system, which is traditionally a centralized one. And data is coming from entire globe. It is coming with a very high speed. So obviously you have to have some different kind of paradigm shift, and a NoSQL movement has given that post. 2010 onwards, you can say something, another, you know, you cannot say revolution, but then because of the phones, we have got all demand applications across multiple industries with specialized requirements. And then this kind of movement, that is the databases on the phones. So we have got two distinct kind of things. One is the very high volume databases, and the NoSQL movement with the distributed databases, and then other kind of things where the memory is less, and then still we want all those things stuff to be loaded in your small devices. So this is what we have seen are changes happening in the database industry. Of course, we'll concentrate today on NoSQL movement more. The NoSQL movement has started obviously because of the distributed of databases, because we cannot keep database in single place and serve the entire globe. So we have to have a distribution that has to have multiple nodes where the data is kept, data is replicated, and all those things. So let us talk about that. And whenever we talk about NoSQL, we invariably have to deal with the CAP theorem. I believe that all of you may be aware of CAP theorem. If it not, we'll just have a look of a CAP theorem. Brewer has actually come up with the CAP theorem, and it has been proven mathematically also. So CAP theorem identified the trade-offs that make best necessary base is a type of database systems. I'm assuming that those who are aware of the distributed databases knows what is the ACID-based systems and a base-based system. The ACID-based are the traditional database RDBMS systems. That is what normally we consider, that the transactions, what happens in the database systems or RDBMS systems, are follow the ACID properties. And similarly, when you talk about the NoSQL type of databases, we see that the transaction follows the base properties. We'll again go in detail in the fast manner about ACID and base, but just see the CAP theorem. The CAP theorem states ultimately that it is impossible for a distributed computer system to simultaneously provide all three of the following guarantees. And this is very, very important. The first one is the consistency. What do you mean by consistency? All nodes see the same data at the same time. That means suppose I have got 10 database servers, and then anybody in the globe is requesting any query, whether it's a read or write, they should see a same data at the same time. That means for a time t equal to 0, if anybody in the globe is accessing a data from any server, they must get the same data. That is what is the CAP theorem assume about the definition of the consistency. Availability, a guarantee that every request receives a response about whether it was successful or failed. That means whenever I want to get an answer from a database system or a request from a database system, I must get a response in a stipulated time period. One thing we should understand about the availability of CAP theorem is that it is not talking about how much time to get an answer, and this is actually a very important scenario, and that is not being taken care of by the CAP theorem, that we should understand very clearly. So response time is not considered in the CAP theorem, but it says that whenever I make a request, I must get an answer, even if the link between the nodes are failed, or even if a particular database server is failed, then also I must get an answer. That is what is the meaning of the availability. And then now what we know is that we feel that availability should be 24/7, and whenever I make a request within a stipulated time, maybe within a span of 1 or 1.5 seconds, I must get an answer. That is what we expect from the database system as a user. The third important fact is the partition tolerance. The system continues to operate despite arbitrary message loss or a failure of part of a system. So let anything happens, out of 10 servers, 5 are down because of the partition breakdown or because of the link breakdown, or have you got two data centers and between the two data centers the link has been broken, maybe because of any reason, my system should work. So that is what is the meaning of partition tolerance. So based on these three concepts, the CAP theorem works, and what CAP says is that you can either of two is possible. If I want to go for C and A, I cannot have partition tolerance. If I want to go for P and A, C is not possible. And if I want to go for C and P, availability is not possible, that CAP says. Now we will basically see that whether it is meaningful in a practical life, and if it is not, what can be done. So first, before going ahead, we'll again have a walkthrough about ACID and BASE, and then we can proceed further. Of course, the ACID is a very known phenomena. Everybody knows about database systems. Each transaction has to have this property, atomic. The transaction should be atomic. That means everything in a transaction succeeds, or the entire transaction is rollback. So either do something or don't do anything. Consistent, a transaction cannot leave the database in an inconsistent state. Now there is an important thing we should understand about this. The consistency in the ACID and the consistency in the CAP theorem is something slightly different. They are not same, that we have to understand very clearly, and then only we can actually understand that where we have to work around if you want to do some sort of research or understanding of the newer trends. The consistency in the ACID-based system is basically talking about the centralized system where the transaction is coming in, and a database should be in consistent state when transaction leaves. The meaning is very simple, that if transaction fails, then it should go back to its own state, whatever the way. And another important fact is that it is a programmer's responsibility if at all there is a business rule to be implemented, and then business rule should not make the transaction in inconsistent state. For a simple example, that is a traditional example normally we see about the consistency, is if I am taking out the money from one bank account and depositing another one, then there is a possibility of two different transactions, one a debit, other a credit. If I just talk about atomicity and if I make these two transactions separate, then my database will go in inconsistent state because transaction number one has worked and transaction number two has failed, and that is not a consistent state. So ACID property is talking about this kind of consistency along with the consistency with respect to system also. So system-based consistency and the programmer-based consistency are important. So in this particular case, a programmer has to take care of that both these events should be grouped in a single transaction, so that because of the atomic property, consistency will be taken care of. CAP is not talking about this kind of consistency. It is assuming that this consistency or local level consistency has been taken care of. CAP is talking about the consistency with respect to multiple nodes and what data different users will read when there is a failure, or even if there is no failure, if there is a link delays, whether all the people will read same thing at the same time. So the consistency definition of CAP and consistency definition of the ACID are different, that we should understand very clearly, and then only we can understand what is happening in the today's world. Third is isolation. These are the two things are very simple. Transaction cannot interface with each other. That is an obvious thing and normal thing. And of course, everybody has to follow this, whether it is a current system or older one. Durability is again an obvious thing, that once it is committed, come what may. Even my server is failed, even my hard disk is failed, or even anything is failed. The durability is important. That means if I book a ticket, that's it. Whether anything is damaged, then also whatever I booked is permanent thing. So that durability, obviously, we got so many ways to take care of durability, and that is a proven technique, so no issues about that. Come to the base. An alternative to ACID is a base. Now just see that when we talk about the base-based systems, we are dealing with the distributed databases, that we should understand first. When you talk about ACID systems, we are not strictly talking about the distributed databases, but we are actually talking about the centralized database systems. So as soon as I'm saying about the base, the availability is a major concern. Because when I say distribution is basically done to enhance the availability. People from anywhere should get a data. And so the basic availability is a major requirement which is to be followed by a transaction. So basic availability, a soft state. What is soft state, we'll see, and an eventual consistency. So these three things are the de facto standard of the base-based databases. Okay, now let us see that base-based databases and NoSQL databases, and then how they go with each other. No, first of all, that NoSQL term itself is confusing. All of us aware that, I think, that not only SQL is a basic full form, but actually we must say a non-relational databases. That is, NoSQL databases are fundamentally non-relational databases. Along with that, they all are distributed one, and so we say that they are horizontally scalable. The meaning of horizontally scalable is that whenever the demand increases, what we do is that we go on adding physically a new server to the system. So go on adding the new servers, so horizontally we are scaling it. Whereas when you talk about the traditional database systems or RDBMS based database system, they are vertically scalable. That means we add the extra resources to the same system, that is improving the, you know, memory or adding the more cores and something of that kind. But there will be one or two servers at the most, and then there can be replicas or partial replications, but not beyond that. Whereas in the NoSQL movement, and when we talk about the distributed databases with respect to non-relational database systems, we are actually working with the distributed network applications, and then they are across the globe, and then many, many servers and data is distributed, data is fragmented and distributed over the globe at many places. And so they can rapidly scale across a growing network consisting of multiple interconnected nodes. So all these interconnected nodes are across the globe, and then of course data is unstructured and semi-structured. So these are the basic requirements, and then these requirements cannot be catered by the normal SQL databases, and that is why NoSQL database is actually not a war between SQL and NoSQL, but NoSQL is actually and fundamentally a different paradigm for different kind of applications, particularly with the social applications and social sites and all. We have to have a unstructured and semi-structured data. we cannot say it is a totally unstructured, but a semi-structured data, and then of course some structured data is also present in a NoSQL kind of database systems. But that is very important. They are not fully ACID compatible. And then again, for obvious reason, due to CAP theorem. Because if we want C, then A and P, out of that I can choose only one. And when you obviously say it is distributed system, we are talking about A and P more, because we want availability, we want partition tolerance, because unless there is a partition tolerance, there is no point having distributed database systems, because there are multiple servers. So obviously our system should work when there is a partition among the different servers, or some servers are failing, some links are failing, and all such things. So when I'm talking about A and P, or I want A and P, then C I have to compromise. That is what is the CAP theorem is talking about. And that is why there is a problem with NoSQL kind of database. And so we have to overcome out of this. Let us see in more detail. When we talk about a CAP theorem, obviously I said that there can be three categories. Whether the categories are actually not a clear cut one, I mean, theoretically they are clear cut one, practically they are not. We'll see in movement why it is so. A CP database, that is consistency and a partition tolerance, that is database which is basically taking this C and P as a major goal, and because of that availability, at the expense of availability, you can have C and P, because CAP says that out of three, only two are possible. Now this two are possible sentence is not very rigid. We have to understand that very, very clearly, that when I say C and P exist, that means it doesn't mean that A will not be exist at all. Because any practical system, if I say that availability is not possible, if I want to maintain C and P, is meaningless. So then what CAP says? Yeah, the problem is that as soon as I'm saying C and P, and if I really go with the real definition of C and real definition of P of CAP, then yes, A is impossible. But that but is very important, that in all practical circumstances, we do not go with the complete definition of CAP, but then we dilute the definitions and then work around. We'll see in more detail, because after this we'll basically working around some case studies, and then we can understand that how can we proceed further in the development of the new world. Again, come back to the CP systems. The system has to shut down the non-consistent node, that is make it unavailable until the partition is resolved. That is where the problem is. That means the availability is not possible. So if anything happens, the system has to shut down the non-consistent node to maintain the consistency. Now, as soon as I choose to maintain the consistency, the system will become unavailable, and that is why I am at the expense of availability, I am trying to maintain the consistency in the system. The AP kind of database, that is the goal of development is A and P. So when a partition occurs, all nodes remain available. That is the major thing what we talk about A, which is not the case of CP. So here, even if there is a partition, we are continue or allowing the people to utilize the system or any node in the system, even if there is a partition. And so availability is highest. Just understand that availability is highest. That is my goal. And so since availability is highest and P obviously has to be there, because I'm talking about distributed databases, so obviously I have to do or work around with the consistency. So obviously what will happen? The partition is there, so out of three machines, one is, or the link between two machines is lost. So the other machine will be obviously inconsistent, because whatever is happening to that machine cannot able to, you know, work around with the other machines. And so my database can go in inconsistent state. So those at the wrong end of the partition might return an older version of data, because the correct version is available in the other machines, because people have modified the data in the other side of the partition. So when the partition is resolved, the system has to repair or resolve all the inconsistencies. For example, in the first partition, we have done some updates on a particular data item, and the same update or similar kind of update has happened on the other partition. So obviously, we have to see to it that the timestamping of both, and then accordingly, we have to update database. But that can only happen when we resolve the partition, and then we have to go through the logs of both the partitions, and then we have to make the database in consistent state, and then we can go ahead. Now, obviously, with doing so, for some period of time, my database will be in inconsistent state. That is what is the bottom line of AP kind of database, which is something we feel odd, but in a practical life and a particular kind of application, this is okay. Particularly, we just think over about Facebook and other things that, okay, I have done some changes in my Facebook profile, and then that particular server is actually a partition server. So whatever I have uploaded from my side and somebody endorsed to me and some other side of partition, so it is not available to me for some period of time, but when the partition is restored, whatever has happened on that side of server will get uploaded to me, and then at the end of some period of time, I will get the updated version. So till that time, I will get the older version, and after the partition is restored, I will get a newer version. So that kind of the meaning of the inconsistencies. A CA database delivers consistency and availability. So as soon as I'm saying C and A has to happen in any case, then I can't do this if there is a partition between any two nodes. So as soon as there are partition between two nodes, both C and A are not possible, or that is impossible. As soon as I have seen that either C is possible or A is possible, just now we have seen in the examples of CP and AP databases. So when I say that I want to have with CA, then the partition tolerance is not possible, and therefore it can't deliver a fault tolerance. So that is the problem with the CA kind of databases. So we can understand that the CA kind of databases are our older things, which we are working with the central database or a partially replicated databases. So our distributed database system, which we people have studied in our courses, or possibly we are teaching or we are learning. So all these things we have learned, that how to make the relational database system in a distributed environment. And then we have learned so many algorithms. But then in all such cases, traditionally, the partition tolerance is a very, very difficult to implement when you talk about the relational database systems. So come back to this point. So this category belongs to traditional non-distributed or partially replicated systems. Again, I'm saying that they are not necessarily relational. So there can be a system which are non-relational systems only providing C and A, but in that case, the partition tolerance will be different, or extent of partition tolerance will not be that good. That is what is the meaning of this. Now, if you come down, what the industry wants. We want distributed databases, but obvious, we can't escape from this. We want consistency, we want availability, we want fault tolerance all at the same time, which is what we want, which is what industry want, which is what user want. But CAP says something different. All three at a time is difficult to achieve, or is impossible to achieve. That is what CAP says. We'll come to that point now in the next slides. Now we know that our RDBMS is strong at C. All of us know very clearly that is very, very strong at C, and that is why for transactional database, we are still stick with RDBMS. There is no way out at this moment. We want a proper consistency in all manner. We'll see that concept in more detail in the next few slides. ANP is chosen based upon requirement, but fundamentally it is C. That is what is RDBMS works around. But in non-relational, the good or goal is P and E. Let us see some two case studies, and then we can come back to our basic topic. Let us see a CP kind of database which exists in the market. MongoDB, I think many of you must have used that MongoDB software. and a DBMS system. It is a very, very popular one. MongoDB is a popular NoSQL database management system that stores data as a JSON, a JSON, a binary JSON document. So it is a document data store. It is frequently used for big data and real-time applications. It is extraordinarily very nice for such kind of applications. And of course, you can have multiple different locations. I can create multiple nodes, and then it can work and expand horizontally very, very nicely. If you try to classify, I'm using that word very clearly, that try to classify, because all the systems which are exist in the market, we cannot classify fully as CP or fully as AP. Because if I just say it is CP, that means I'm saying that availability is impossible. No, sorry. This is not really happening in practical life. Though CAP says like that. So what we do is we do some tuning. We'll see that now as a case study. So MongoDB may be classified as CP. I'm just using the word maybe, because it is not a rigid classification according to CAP. It is, but not a MongoDB. It resolves network partition by maintaining consistency while compromising on availability. So while resolving the partition, some period of time, some nodes are not available. Because some nodes are not available for some period of time, whenever there's a partition, we are categorizing this as CP data store, because it focuses more on consistency than availability. That's all. It doesn't mean that it is not a database provides availability. It provides availability very nicely, very well, but when time comes, that means whenever there is a partition, that moment of time, it focuses more on consistency than availability. That is the only meaning of this. And just because of that, we are saying that this is a CP kind of database. So availability is compromised to some extent, not fully. That is what we have to understand. Just move ahead. MongoDB works on the principle of primary master techniques. I believe that anybody, those who have done the course of database management system and distributed databases, the primary master or primary set technique is a very well worked out technique, and then with multiple secondary nodes or replicas. So replication is achieved with the help of multiple nodes. Secondary node has their own replicated data set, and by default, clients also read from the primary nodes. By default, I'm saying you, but writing has to go through primary master, not through any other node. So any reading primarily will go or routed through primary copy, or it can be through secondary, but writing has to be routed through primary side. Just see the structure. This is a reference from the documentation of MongoDB. Just understand this. This is a write operation, because we have to basically concentrate on write operation only. So any write operation will go through a primary node. A primary node will replicate or send a replication message to all secondary nodes. They can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 10. Many secondary nodes are possible. So replication request will be sent by primary node to secondary node. So just see the sequence. The client has requested some write operation or update operation. It is received by primary. Primary has sent to a first secondary replication node. It will send to second, it will send to third, it will send to fourth, and like that. As soon as primary receives a reply from any of the secondary that okay, it has done the updation on its copy, primary gives back the reply to the client. It will not wait till all secondary nodes gives you back the answer. That is very important. That means we are compromising to some extent of consistency, because otherwise, if you go with the definition of CAP theorem of consistency, then unless all 10 secondary nodes gives or writes down or updates the query, we should not make them available for the user to read, because the consistency in CAP theorem says that for a given point of time, if there is a request from any client to any node, they must return you the same data. Now, just if you see this particular aspect of MongoDB, this will not happen. There will be some delay in this, because even if one node says yes, then the primary site will simply say the transaction is completed to the user, and then the secondary nodes will slowly catch up, and then they will update their log and then the database. So that is how it happens in the MongoDB. So the consistency which we talk about in terms of CAP is not fully achieved, but to some extent it is done. So this is the same thing. Each replica set can have only one primary node that receives all the write operations. All other nodes in the same replica set are secondary nodes that replicate the primary node's operations log and apply it to their own data set. Yes, that is very important thing we all of know, I think, that when the primary wants to communicate with secondary, it will communicate only, it will send only the log to the secondary, and based on log, the data set is uploaded, not the query. So query is not executed at secondary nodes, none of the secondary nodes rather. The query will be executed only at a primary node, and a log is basically passed to the secondary node. When the primary node becomes unavailable, the secondary node with the most recent operation log will be elected as the new primary node. That is what is the meaning of this. That let us assume that in the first case, primary has returned to the secondary, and then it has given back the reply, okay, it has done. And then whenever the primary is moving to the different secondaries, and then the primary has conked off. So now primary is not available, but primary. So what the secondaries will do now, that all the secondaries will interact with each other through the heartbeats. I think the heartbeats, you know, is a scenario you will be knowing, basically to, you know, synchronize the vector clocks. So whenever they try to do that, they will come to know that this particular secondary has the recent log, and so this secondary will become a primary now, and then based upon this log, secondary will ask other secondaries to replicate or send a replication request, and then the other secondaries will replicate the data. So that is how this secondary will now become primary and all others will become secondary nodes. That is a standard phenomena, nothing new. Move towards the AP kind of database now. The Cassandra is another example. So these two databases, why are taken is they are two distinct kind of databases, though they are NoSQL community, and they are behaving in a different way. For the user perspective, of course, there is a difference. I just now said that in the case of MongoDB, for a slight moment of time, whenever there is a partition, there can be unavailability. There can be unavailability because unless the new master takes up, it sends the replication request to another master, and then work around, it takes some time, and for that period of time the database is unavailable to all users, and that is why we are terming this as a kind of CP database. Come to the Cassandra, its architecture is totally different because the MongoDB is working on the primary side technique, whereas the AP database is working on the masterless architecture. That means there is no site is a master, all are at equivalent level. And another difference is that MongoDB is a document store, whereas AP or a Cassandra is a white collar database. Just see that related to CAP theorem, what happens? Cassandra may be classified as AP database. It delivers availability and partition tolerance, but can't deliver consistency all the time. So the consistency level in the Cassandra is not good with respect to MongoDB, I can say. MongoDB also has got some kind of consistency issues, but they are not that critical. Just we have seen that slight delay can happen, but as such database is in a proper consistent state, though not exactly according to CAP consistency. Again, I'm repeating that. because if you want to go with the cap consistency, then obviously availability is not possible. So we want a degree of availability and degree of consistency. So if you see a MongoDB point of view, consistency is more important. That is how they are designed. Whereas in the case of Cassandra, they are talking about availability. So all the time the data should be available. And that is where they're coming with the notion of eventual consistency is taken care of. So come back to this. So how here Cassandra provides eventual consistency by allowing clients to write to any node at any time and reconciling inconsistencies as quickly as possible. That means even if there are partitions, even if there are link failures, then also all the nodes will be always available, even if there can be some kind of inconsistency exist for some period of time. Once the links are established, then all the nodes will reconcile everything, they will repair. So there is a specific repair operation exist in the Cassandra, and that has to be fine-tuned by the database administrator according to the requirement of the applications. And there is obviously, when I'm talking about this eventual consistency, there is a possibility that some transactions you have to roll back and redone, even if they are completed. So to some extent, I am not even following the durability property. That is a major thing we have to understand. So the pure transaction cannot be achieved with the help of Cassandra. But then, if we want to work around with the applications like social media related things, the Cassandra is a very good choice. The third kind, which is actually I cannot categorize under this phenomena because this is a totally different paradigm, but just for completeness, because the NoSQL movement has started with the distributed database systems and other aspects, this particular graph database is a totally a different approach altogether to model, to store, and to run the queries. Just for completeness, I have put it over here, but this is not a topic of discussion today. So what is graph database is data and relationships are equally important. So we are storing data and relationship together. A kind of graph is created. And visualization also is through a graph. It is intended to hold data without constraints to a predefined model. That is, I do not have something like foreign keys, primary keys, and such things. We have got a nodes and a relationship between the nodes and the lymph nodes. Expensive join operations are totally eliminated. So basically the fundamental drawbacks of RDBMS are tried to be eliminated. So it is a paradigm shift. A designer has to think in a different manner if I want to design or create a database in a graph database systems. Querying millions of records is extremely fast because there are no joins. So millions of records can be, you know, queried very fastly. So if my query processing engine, particularly that is a major issue when we talk, when we are having millions of records and then many tables has to be joined and come up with a query, a major challenge happens with the RDBMSs. So graph data is trying to take care of such things. So basically, though they are not using RDBMS, because of that, we are just categorizing there as NoSQL, but they are not really, we cannot consider them as a CPAP or related to the CAP theorem terminology. So it is a totally different paradigm. We are not concentrated on this today. But then this is just for completeness. We can just see a Neo4j is a nice example of a graph database. So we can just visualize that database is created in this particular manner. This is a relationship. A relationship can have a value. So employee and company. So employee has started with the company on a start date. So value for has CEO relationship. The company is located in a particular city. And like that, so we can have a relationship, we can have a data can have a values, and relationship also can have a values. And we are simply storing in this particular format with the language. So there is nothing like table creation or creation of the structure or semi-structure like what happens in a MongoDB or in other kind of databases. We create a node, we create a value to, we give a value to a node, we create a relationship, and we can assign a value to the relationship. That is how the creation process happens in Neo4j. We'll move our attention to the current trends now, because CAP is there and CAP is restricting ourselves too much. So come back to this particular thing. What is happening now? What is industry demands we already seen? What it wants is the unstructured as well as structured data. That is very important thing now. Amount of data is too high, terabytes and petabytes. So we cannot continue with your normal systems again. Availability demand is very, very high from customer perspective, from, you know, database community or anybody perspective. We literally want database to work for 24/7. And that too with the not only just availability we are talking about, but response time. That is also very important. So response time should be very, very small, probably in milliseconds or at the most 1 or 2 seconds. We cannot go less than that. That is what is the expectation. The expectation is very high. And if you see this expectation, along with that, we want proper consistency. That is what we think about. That means the industry say that somehow you blow the cap. Somehow. But CAP says that if CA is there, if P is not possible, AP is there, C is not possible, and CP is there, A is not possible. So our entire attention is how can you dilute the CAP, because we cannot blow the CAP completely. We have to dilute the CAP. That is what our attention is, and that is the area of research today. Let us go ahead now. So beyond the CAP, what is it? What is the consistency of the CAP? If you understand that, then we can blow the CAP very nicely. Okay, so the CAP consistency actually means linear reliability. Don't confuse with the serializability, what we talk about in the case of, you know, ACID properties and concurrency control of the database management systems or RDBMS systems. Linear reliability is something related to distributed databases. And consistency in the CAP is actually the CAP theorem means is a linear reliability. And they assume that a linear reliability should happen. And then that is what is the meaning of consistency. And that kind of consistency, if exists, then either I can have A or B. But really speaking, in all practical purposes, we need not have to have this very, very strong notion of linear reliability, but I can have a diluted version of linear reliability, and in that case, I can achieve A also, P also, and to some extent, C also. So that is what is the ultimate meaning of CAP theorem, and beyond CAP, now we have to see, and that is how people are already working around beyond CAP terminologies. Just come back to this consistency of CAP is something like that. The availability of CAP is basically what it says is every request received by a non-failing node, database node of course, in the system must result in a non-error response. Again, this is a very stringent requirement. Very, very stringent. If I want to go with that, then as soon as I want to go for this kind of availability, then the consistency is obviously impossible to maintain. So again, we are diluting this availability concern to some extent. So if you dilute availability to some extent, if you dilute consistency to some extent, then I can have all the three things together. That is what we are trying to do, because P we cannot dilute. If you dilute P, nothing will happen. So we cannot dilute P in any case. So our systems will ultimately merge to a same kind of system where I got consistency to some extent, I got availability to some extent, maybe 80% consistency, I can say 90% consistency, and so on and so forth. And then I can say that I got C, I got A, and I got P. At few moment of time, my system will not be available. For some moment of time, my system will not be consistent, but then otherwise system is having C also, having A also, and having P also. That is what is the meaning of the beyond CAP concept. Let us see that linear serializability, what they're talking about is a very interesting example. A courtesy from Martin Kleppmann. Just see here that there is a, you know, query, insert into final score, player 1, score 1, player 2, score 2, and then values Germany, comma 1, comma Argentina, comma 0. That means it's a goals. So Germany has got one score and Argentina has got zero score. That is what I want to insert. So this is the referee. Referee has inserted this at this particular moment of time T. It is inserted in a database, name of database, leader or a primary site. It is put over here. There's a time, some time it will take to, you know, update database. Once it's updated, that moment of time, the same insert command is sent to the follower, same to the another follower. Okay, that means two other database systems, it is being sent, and at the same moment of time, it is saying okay to the user, that is the referee. So this particular period, the leader database has updated its own log and database and has sent the same query to the replicated sites. Now see that what is happening. Now this follower database has received, it has updated its own database, and that moment of time, a user Alice, she has sent a query select star from final score and it has received. What it will receive obviously is the final score Germany 1, Argentina 0, and say this Alice will say, yeah, Germany has won the World Cup because she has got a good response that okay, Germany 1, Argentina 2, Argentina 0, and so it got a response. Just see now what is happening. At the same or after some period of time, a bot has run a similar query. Maybe after say half second or 1 second or maybe after 30 milliseconds after Alice. But then what is happening? The query of Bob has landed to follower 2 and not to follower 1. The query of Bob has landed to a database follower 1, no issues. But it has landed to follower 2 and then follower 2 is not having this data. Follower 2 might have got all data where Germany 0 and Argentina 0. And so he's saying that really? Website saying no? Obviously, because it has got a older data. I cannot see a stale data. I cannot see this as an inconsistent data. It is the old data actually. But what CAP says is that for any moment of time, each and every node must get the same data. If I really want to achieve that, just try to understand that. If I really want to achieve that, then a leader node could not have replied over here. Over here at this moment of time, it should have wait till both these two nodes have updated data. That means from this point onward up to this point, the leader node has to wait, and then only leader node could have given a reply back to referee that okay, the things have done. And till that moment of time, up to this point, I must not allow any query to happen. That means for this period of time, my system will go unavailable to the users, which is not really required when you talk about the practical database systems. So we are saying that is linear availability. It's a very strong notion and which is not really required. So if you want to achieve linear availability, then I cannot immediately reply back to referee, but I have to wait till all my follower databases had completed updation. Till that time, I should make my database unavailable. And once that is done, I will say my database updated, and I will say the referee back, okay, your transaction is done. So my referee also has to wait long. That means response time for referee will be very high. My system will become unavailable for each and every update happens in a system, which is not practicable. And that is why we have to blow the CAP. We did not have to bother about the consistency what CAP theorem talk about. And that is what exactly happening, that all the versions of new database systems are not working towards the linear scalability, but they are only talking about delayed updates. And in that period of time, they should just continue like that only. And so this particular period of time, there can be a slight inconsistencies or a delayed response can happen to Bob. But if Bob re-query the same database after say half second or 1 second, he will get a correct result. So that is what we experience now also in web services. So that is what is the meaning of the notion of linearity reliability. Come down to the availability issue of the cap. So suppose again go back to, we have got a two data center, data center one, data center two, and there is an interruption over here. What will happen now? The application continues to be allowed to write to database. If I'm talking about availability, so it remains fully available in both data centers. That means users over here also can update, user over here also can update, even if there is a link break. So any changes that are written in one data center will not appear in the other data center, and this violates the linear reliability. Of course, yes. If you don't want to lose linear reliability, you have to make sure you do all your reads and writes in one data center, which you may call the leader, and in the other data center, the database must stop accepting reads and writes. That is what exactly I tried to tell in the earlier example, or basically the same example in the earlier diagram, that unless a data center follower one and follower two both has got updates, or both could able to update, we should not accept any query from Bob. So Bob has to wait till follower two updates the query which is coming from the leader. So that is where the problem is. So we are not actually working around a linear reliability. So CAP does not consider many of the aspects apart from this, and that is where we have to dilute many of the aspects of CAP. CAP only talking about the fault likes nodes remains up, but the network between some of them is not working. Nodes can crash, they can be rebooted, they can run out of space, they can be a bug. So many problems, so many problems. CAP is not considering any of such problem. It is only considering the network partition. It is not only even considering about the latency. So if I'm talking about availability and consistency of the CAP, then the latency will be very high. So that is not being considered by CAP. So in all practical purposes, I cannot stick with the C and A of CAP also. So when we discuss all these things, now what we should do with the research? Simply, all the algorithms which we are already learned in a distributed database environment, all those environments are extremely, extremely important. Only thing is that we have to work around C and A and dilute the C. Just see some examples so that you can understand in more detail. So different algorithms which are in use with distributed database systems are required to be relearned. Not actually, I should say, rediscovered with the NoSQL terminologies. Just come to the partitioning or the fragmentation issues. Normally, we work with a simple hashing, but a simple hashing, we have to convert it to a consistent hashing. You can read the paper which is there from 1998, and people have understood that, okay, if you want to go about distributed systems and a NoSQL kind of things, then I must, modify to some extent the hashing algorithm. Because we have to take care of the partition, we have to take up the replication particularly, and as soon as there is replication, I cannot work with a simple hash algorithm. Because we have to take care of the horizontal scalability and replication. So the consistent hashing is the one of the very nice algorithm. Now if you go ahead, the today's world, the consistent hashing algorithm is still modified. So it is further modified as a multi-token per node algorithm. You can refer the Cassandra documentation, you can refer the Neo4j documentation, and you can see the different dialects of the consistent hashing, and a lot of research is happening with the hashing techniques for the replication phenomena. So when I want to replicate the node, how to replicate my particular rows. So for example, I got 100 rows, and then I want to distribute them or fragment them in the multiple nodes. So the first 10 rows will go on first hash, second will go on a second hash, and third hash, and like that. But that is fine when I'm talking about a simple hash. But when there's a replication, what will happen? Whenever there's a failure, then how can I find out that which node contains a particular replica? So for that, I will require some modification in the basic algorithm. So as a research direction, we must of course know the basic algorithms. We must know that how can I make changes to the basic algorithm to fit with our basic fragmentation need, basic replication needs. And then when I do replication and when I modify, then I should get back the data from the hash. So this is where the things are about the partitioning related algorithms. When you talk about consistency algorithms, I believe that whenever we talk about consistency, the vector clocks are the one which are being used everywhere in all systems. There is another good paper on Dynamo database from the Amazon and other things. So the vector clocks are being used, and vector clocks are basically traditionally being invented long back, somewhere in 1980s, that people, when talking about distributed systems, distributed operating systems, the vector clocks are being implemented. But then in the case of distributed operating system, things are much more simpler compared to databases, because in the case of operating systems, we are not talking about replications, and so the things are easier to implement. So the traditional vector clock algorithms cannot be used as it is in the case of database systems. So a lot of scopes indeed to write easier, faster algorithms, but giving eventual consistency, what we want is, we do not want the pure consistency in the terminology of the CAP. And so if you want to go with the simpler notion of eventual consistency, then again the vector clock based synchronization algorithm can be simplified to or modified according to the requirement of the eventual consistency. And so there are so many such kind of dialects of vector clocks are there in the market. Different kind of applications are using those, different kind of products are using the versions of vector clocks algorithms. And then a lot of research is happening that how to synchronize the different replicas, different nodes in the database systems. And then everywhere we can see the research by manipulating or changing those algorithms to work with the eventual consistency aspects of the NoSQL. Another one example is the last write wins. Last write wins is the dialect of the vector clock, and it is being used by the MongoDB. So where every mutation is time stamped, and then the latest version of data is the winning value. We can, if you know the vector clock and then the simple clock, so basically the combination of the vector clock and simple clock, and then we are only seeing the simple clock, and if the vector clock is inconsistent, we'll simply sync it. So there is no need to every time sync the vector clock. That is what is the new algorithm is talking about. Otherwise, in the vector clock phenomena, we have to synchronize the vector clock after every or some interval of time. That is not really required when you talk about the eventual consistencies. We'll talk about the replications. A standard replication algorithms can be coupled with the network topologies. Yeah, this is very important now, that the replication algorithms are there, exist in long back. If you even read the older books like the Korth and Nawathi and all, then also you can have a different replication algorithm exist. But when you talk about the distributed systems along with the NoSQL paradigm, and then the consistencies and availability issues, we have to basically should able to consider the network topology also, because the data center has got so many cores, and within the core also there can be failures. So when you talk about that, my algorithm should able to configure where I am replicating everything. I should able to see the physical topology of the network about for the replication. So the replication process should not be automatic, but it should be manually controlled through a database administrator. If that happens, then I can very nicely control my replications. And then even if a particular data center rack is failed, then also my system should be available. So if that to happen, my network topology should be the input to the system, and system should know that the which node is located in which rack, the particular rack contains how many nodes, in out of those node which node contains which kind of replica, and then the system can rebalance the things. So that is what is the one possibility to add something to a replication algorithms. Another possibility is the sharding techniques. Now, sharding technique is shards are created, and in each shard contain are different replicas. And generally, we'll say that if I got 5 shards and each shard has got 4 replicas, then we say that the replicas in the shard number 1 should be the major replica or the primary replica. Shard number 2 has got replica of the another fragment, and like that. So each shard should contain a different replica or different master replica, and then we hash it and we go ahead. But then there can be different kinds of ideas, different possibilities. Enormous possibilities are there. How to shard a database? How to maintain a replica on the shard? How to make the hashes on the shards? And then so on and so forth. And not only that, with respect to the failure and the network topologies, again the shard network topology and your rack and the physical location, physical country location of your database center is also matters. So my system should take care of those things. So the algorithm has to modify it accordingly. So basic sharding algorithm, basic replication algorithm has to take care of such aspects, and that is what is the active area of research in the point of view of replications. So partitioning, replication, and the consistency are the three major areas where the research is going on when you talk about NoSQL movement and the CAP theorem. So particularly, again, we'll come back to the CAP theorems. That CAP theorem is particularly, we are diluting the CAP theorem in with respect to availability and consistency. And so now all the things which we found in the real practical uses, they are all giving consistency also, they are all giving availability also, and they all giving partition tolerance also. But then some period of origin of time, some system will not give you availability, some system will not give you pure consistency. That's all. So basically, the CAP theorem is now diluted to that extent that I can fine-tune my database that okay, for this moment of time, I want availability more than consistency. But for this particular moment of time, I want availability more than consistency, and my database management system should allow me as a DAB to do so. So that is what is happening. And so basically there is a merging from CA database to AP database and AP database to CP database. So as such, we are categorizing there are CP, AP and CA, but as such, all are merging towards the single goal that we have got more availability, we have got more consistency, and there is a P. Fault tolerance related thing also. This is a fantastic algorithms. We are already learned in the distributed database systems, and traditionally we work with the voting protocols when we have got a multi-master environment. If it is a single mastermind environment like a MongoDB, things are much more simpler. That how the only question is that how to choose the master from the secondaries, because there is only a single master. When master fails, I got multiple secondaries, and among those multiple secondaries, I have to choose the next primary. And then once the secondary node becomes primary node, then all others become secondaries. So that is a simpler technique, and that is very well available, and the algorithms are there to work around. Of course, there is a possibility to modify those algorithms to some extent, but then the scope is limited. But when you talk about the multi-master systems, there are n number of protocols available. Voting protocol is the traditional protocols which we talk about distributed database systems in a relational environment also. But then there are so many versions of voting protocols available. One of that is the Gaussian protocol, which is being proposed by Cassandra. So if you see the documentation, you can understand that it is a lot of work is going on in this particular area of voting algorithms when you talk about the multi-master systems. So multi-master system is becoming the more and more standard, particularly when you talk about the huge data to handle, and I want availability for all the times. Because if the availability is a major goal, then obviously I must go with the multi-master environment and not with the single master environment scenario. Fine. Of course, now there are a few systems which are coming, which is basically a mixture or hybrid of the single master and multi-master systems. That means I can have more than one primary site. As soon as I am saying more than one primary site, it becomes a multi-master system. But in the case of pure multi-master system, all the database nodes are primary nodes. And when I say hybrid system, if I got 10 nodes out of that, only 2 or 3 can become primary, but not all. For a particular fragment, of course, because primary node notion is for a particular fragment. So let us talk about the concluding remarks that we have discussed the fundamentals of CAP and then how the system is merging towards the goal of having everything in one. That is, I want C, I want A, and I want P together, and accordingly we are modifying the algorithm and then giving all the three together to the, you know, user. That is what is the final aspect. Let us see what happening now. This is what exactly happening in the area of research. That is, we are blowing the CAP out, not blowing it out as such, but no need to worry about the CP or AP or CA right now, because nothing is pure now. No database is purely CP, no database is purely AP, or no database is purely ECA. So we need not have to worry about that. We are basically diluting. We are neither working with CAP constancy nor with capability concepts. So we are now not stick with the CAP constancy concept, or nor even stick with the CAP availability concept fully. To some extent, yes. In fact, both earlier cases studied are already moved out of CAP. That is, if you see MongoDB, if you see Cassandra, they are not strictly AP or a CP or AP databases. There can be towards CP, that is MongoDB is more towards CP, but still it has got A, whereas Cassandra is more towards AP, but still it has got a good consistency mechanism. So like that, each and every database management system is now moving out of CAP and moving towards all at a time. So we are now having some degree of availability and practically acceptable consistency. That is what now all DBM systems, today's database systems, are giving to the user. And so there is a lot of scope to research on. Thus, we have a system with P and then 80% of consistency, 80% of availability, and like that I can talk about. But I cannot say that is a purely CP system, purely AP system, and purely CA system like that. All the algorithms which were in use previously which are studied in the distributed computing, distributed database systems, and then the database system with respect to a pure RDMS, all are there in use, but we have to modify according to the need, according to the node, according to the goal and architecture of a particular database management system which is under development. Another thing which is happening is that the base systems are moving from pure base theory to add a C to it. That is again thing. That means the base database systems are becoming acidic and acid database systems are becoming basic. So that is what is another merger I can say. So even NoSQL databases are adding SQL or dialect of SQL in their feeder. Again, I am repeating that the NoSQL word itself is a, you know, incorrect word, because no, we have nothing to do with the SQL language as such. What is happening in NoSQL is actually a non-relational thing, and because of that, SQL is there, SQL is going to exist, and that is what exactly happening, that NoSQL database systems are having SQL language over there, or a dialect of SQL. Particularly if you see the many NoSQL databases are having a syntax similar to SQL, or very much similar to SQL rather. Eventually, the bulk of NoSQL is marching towards practically useful system, accommodating structured and unstructured data with C, A, and P, with of course a loose definition of C and A. Otherwise, we all know that C, A, P together is not possible. And thus blowing CAP, and again SQL is becoming part and parcel of the many products. So you can see that there is a lot of fusion happening in the entire trend of the database management system. So we have got C, C, we have got A, we have got P, and we have got SQL also. Now come back. So that is what is the happening in the today's world, and the different data DBMS systems are coming up, and then they are actually working towards this. A lot of fusion is happening, and then because of that, a lot of scope in the research area is there. So thank you very much. Any questions are there? I'm happy to answer.
Yes, sir. We have some question. May I ask?
Yes, surely.
Sir, as a student, what is that we have to learn to work in the area of distributed database?
Okay, fine. See, now when you talk about a distributed databases, we have to face basically know the fundamental algorithms of a distributed databases. Now I have discussed some few algorithms in this entire presentation. So something like the vector clock, something like the scalar clock, something the algorithm with respect to primary site technique, the algorithm related to replications. All those fundamental algorithms should be very well known. Once those algorithms known, because as I said, that the research is happening on those algorithms only. I mean, nothing is happening as something totally new algorithm coming up and then people are working with. It is not happening like that. So the old algorithms are there, they will exist. Those old algorithms we have to model according to the goal of the particular database management system. So if my database management system is with respect to multi-node database management system, I have to modify my replication algorithm accordingly. If it is already been modified by some researchers, then I have to optimize that. I have to add some more new ideas to it so that my consistency problem can be solved, and like that and like. So basically the old algorithm which we have studied, if you have already studied a distributed database course or distributed computing course with respect to operating systems, all those algorithms which we have studied are very well applicable with new direction of NoSQL movement. That is all you have to study.
Thank you, sir.
Anything else?
Next question. Which database is good, MongoDB or Cassandra?
See, the thing is, there is no clear answer. That is what I'm trying to tell you. That as such at this stage, if you see that their architectural difference are there. So what exactly you want for your application? So if you see the example of MongoDB, MongoDB type of application, I should say, I shall not say a MongoDB. MongoDB is just one case study because it belongs to one category. The category is something like that it is more towards the consistency than the availability. That's all. More, I'm using the word more towards consistency than availability. It doesn't mean that key the availability is at stake. It is a very nice database. The availability is almost there. Only thing is that it is giving precedence of consistency over the availability. So my database will be in consistent state for a lesser period of time compared to the other architectures. Okay, but as soon as I'm moving towards the other kind of database, that is the databases which are Cassandra-like databases, what is happening is that I am giving precedence of availability. So all the time my nodes are always available, but there is a possibility of inconsistencies more compared to MongoDB kind of databases. And another problem when you talk about the AP kind of database is that there is a possibility that very rarely, of course, that a particular transaction which is committed may have to be rolled back. For a simplest possible example, if I book a ticket and then I may get a confirmation, and within few seconds I will get my money back, and I can say and then somebody will say that okay, no, this transaction has failed. So the durability property and consistency property is somewhat played around at the cost of availability, and this is a very, very rare situation. Try to understand that. Very, very rare. So once in a lifetime, once this can happen, so we did not have to really worry about. But theoretically, yes, this can happen with the system which are more towards AP, but this will not happen towards the system which are more towards CP. That's all. So as such, system point of view, I cannot say this is good or this is bad. This depends upon what kind of application you are running. So if you are running a pure transaction based things, then of course you should not go for API databases. You should go for CA databases. But then if I am running something which is not mission critical, API databases are fantastic because availability is almost always there. It is impossible that API database will have a downtime. So that is all. I mean, we have to see what we are want to. That is a trade-off we have to work around. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing the knowledge of current trends in database management system with us. Thank you, sir. On behalf of Saket Research Sale, a small token of our appreciation on behalf for you, sir. Please accept it with your sincere thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for giving me opportunity to speak in front of the audience. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.